Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to yet another fantastic lecture for today. And of course, we continue from where we stopped in our last class. Today, we're going to treat a very interesting topic. And I believe, as social workers, it's going to help us to understand how to solve issues affecting women. Ladies and gentlemen, our topic for today is Gender Act of Sierra Leone. The Gender Act of Sierra Leone was passed in 2007. But however, I cannot continue without giving you a background or as a topical outline that will take us to where we'll be going. However, ladies and gentlemen, today our topic will take the following format. We're going to be looking at the background of the topic, that is gender law. We're going to be looking, inserting a video that will help us understand how women across the world are really suffering and their rights are really violated. We are also going to look at a summary of the gender laws. We're going to look at the relevance of gender laws to social work practice. We're going to look at the weaknesses of these gender laws. What are the weaknesses of gender laws? Possible recommendations and possible questions. Ladies and gentlemen, let me take you through the background of this lecture. It is not a secret that for far too long, prior to 2007, women have always been discriminated. Women have always been marginalized. They are always considered as individuals who are weak. They are always considered as people who are supposed to be subjected to ridicule, especially in Sierra Leone. For this reason, the government of this country decided that in the best interest of women, there should be a Gender Act, which was passed in 2007. Ladies and gentlemen, the Gender Act consists of laws that help to protect, defend, and maintain the rights of women in Sierra Leone. The Act consists of the Domestic Violence Act, the Devolution of Estate Act, and the Registration of Marriages and Divorce Act. Prior to the enactment of the Gender Act in 2007, women in Sierra Leone, especially the rural women, were subjected to inhuman treatment and their rights trampled upon. It is not a secret, as I was saying, that prior to 2007, women's rights were violated, it was trampled upon. And definitely, especially in rural Sierra Leone, where husbands were turning their wives into punching bags, where husbands were beating their wives at will. This was a very serious problem. And so, in the best interest of women, because they were considered weaker sex in Sierra Leone, definitely we needed to pass a gender law. And these gender laws consist of the Domestic Violence Act. I know when I say gender laws, some people are confused. Note, when the gender laws consist of the Domestic Violence Act 2007, the Devolution of Estate Act, and the Registration of Customary Marriages and Divorce Act 2007. However, ladies and gentlemen, blacks, as we continue. Now we move up, of course, to. I'm going to show you a video that actually explains that not only Sierra Leone is suffering from domestic violence, from the Devolution of Estate Act, and several other problems affecting women, but across the world, women have always complained. Across the world, women have always been subjected to a lot of problems, have already been subjected to a lot of torture, and these have continuously been manifested in them. Physical abuse, economic abuse, psychological abuse have always been perpetrated against women by men. Ladies and gentlemen, I now take you through a very sound documentary which is going to give you knowledge base of what I'm saying. Relax, I'll be right back. Keep beckoning to me.
He came in the room and he told me to undress. And so I said over my mother's dead body, "You part of me, you my life, you came out of me. How can you want to make sex with me?" So she said, "He'll kill me if I don't." And then I started screaming. And the boy next door, he said, "Hey Kurt, what's wrong with you? It's your mother."
Auntie Veronica, when she went to the police station, they said to her, she's got no blue marks on her. So they don't believe what she's telling them. So they actually told her, "You come here half dead and we'll take up the matter." When I phoned them to come and have this guy taken away from the flat, they told me there's no van. ran down to the police station one morning at 3 a.m. when my husband beat me up. And when I got to the police station, I opened a charge against him. And the guy said to me, the policeman told me, I can arrest your husband, but it's going to be an exchange for sex.
They're so rude to you, and that's what happened to me. The policeman almost smashed the table in half the way he kicked me out of the station, like a dog. Go, get out, Witzek. They don't want to help you, and they treat you like dogs.
We have to take responsibility of ourselves, because we don't get help from the justice system. Because most of the cases, the dockets go missing.
A special police team is investigating the brutal abduction, torture and rape of a 24-year-old woman. Fearing for her safety, she's been moved to an undisclosed location. Gauteng MEC for Health and Safety paid her a visit before she was relocated.
Wednesday, just before midnight, this woman was rushed into hospital fighting for her life. Her body near decay, she had been raped, severely beaten, and her body badly burnt, then dumped. She had been abducted and held hostage at an informal settlement near Bezuidenhout Valley for 2 days. No arrests have been made, but a special investigative team has been set up.
It was Wednesday, and I told my boyfriend that I no longer wanted to be in a relationship with him. He didn't say anything in response. He just got up and left. Then on Friday he came back with some others and they took me from my home to a car. I was so scared. I didn't know what I had done. I tried asking questions, but none of them replied. He put me in the boot of the car and took me to a wooded area. And they tied my hands and began raping me. When they stopped raping me, they started hitting me with bottles.
They were talking,
laughing and drinking. They were also smoking something, but I don't know what it was. They hit me and hit me. I don't remember much of what happened next because I became unconscious. I didn't regain consciousness until I woke up in hospital 7 days later. They cut me here, but I don't know what with, a knife or something. They did hit me here with something, because here there was a deep hole. I didn't have a nose, and I didn't have a mouth. The hospital took flesh from here and made me a new nose and mouth. They cut these three fingers and my toes.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for watching that very fantastic documentary that gives you an highlight of how women across the world are really subjected to ridicule, are really suffering as a result of male, you know, domination and male battling in society. We'll move on. I will now take you to the summary of the Gender Act. That is, I'm going to start with the Registration of Customary Marriage and Divorce Act. One thing I must let you know is that we refer to them as the gender laws of Sierra Leone because they are actually preaching about gender. They are actually ensuring equality. They are actually there to maintain the rights of women. And they are primarily gender laws that help to protect, maintain, and defend the rights of these women. And as social workers, our interest is equality. Our interest is social justice. Our interest is in ensuring that society progresses from nothingness to somewhere else. Our interest is to ensure that society might, you know, metamorphose into development, ladies and gentlemen. Which is why our studying the gender laws is a step in the right direction, and it is going to ensure it shifts our mindset in the right direction. So the three gender laws, that is the Domestic Violence Act, the Devolution of Estate Act, the Restitution of Customary, these are similar laws. They almost have the same provision. They are similar. That is why we are going to combine them and treat them as one. But let me give you an highlight of the Registration of Customary Marriage Act 2007. This act introduces the legal minimum age of marriage to 18 years. Previously, there was no requirement for marriage under customary law. Of course, this is very interesting, ladies and gentlemen. You know, prior to this act, you know, women were forced into marriage before 18. Some of them were not given the opportunity to education. Some of them were, in fact, could be taken to a man at a very young age. The last class I did made reference to that. Can you imagine a very small girl at the age of 3, 4, a man will see that girl and now say, joking, she's gonna be my wife. And then, in traditional settings of Sierra Leone, it all starts maybe around the age of 10. The girl will now begin to give out some rest, remove some rest. And then they will now say, okay, you know, let's put the guy in the Wodo society. And in the Wodo society, the man who was claiming that he's going to be responsible to marry that lady will now take charge of spending money for the initiation ceremony. Just after that, we'll now begin to see that maybe just after the Wodo society or so. In fact, they now view the Wodo society as a passage to womanhood. Therefore, the girl is now fit for marriage. This has been happening across the world. But I thank God for this act that now says 18 years is the only age that is recommended for a girl to be able to get married. And also, marriage is not going to be by force anymore, but there must be consent. I like this. Consent, that means an agreement between what? The two partners, the male and the female. It's not only going to be on the side of the male. Both of them must agree that yes, love each other, they want to spend time with each other and definitely want to marry each other. Without that, that is a serious crime, an offense you have committed according to the Registration of Customary Marriage and Divorce Act. However, ladies and gentlemen, the consent of both spouses is now needed for marriage to become valid. Previous girls' consent is not required. Previously, girls' consent is not required, and as a result, forced marriage was very common, which results in unhappy union and divorce. You see that? I'm telling you, at first, no consent. A parent, in fact, when they want to marry a girl, they just go to meet the parent and meet the parent. The parent approves on behalf of the girl. The girl now goes to marriage unhappily, and sometimes, by the time the girl gets mature, divorce comes in. And then, suffering. A lot of problems were happening as a result of that. But I thank God for this act, and I believe social workers will really appreciate the intervention or the enactment of this particular act. Let's see what happens. Also, married women, we are now entitled to own property. Previously, women could only inherit 30% of her husband's property. Why is the letter? You see, this was very inhuman. I can tell you categorically clear, prior to this, to the enactment of the gender laws, especially the Registration of Customary, right? Men were the only ones who had the opportunity, the rights to actually inherit properties when the wife died, the wife of the property at 100%. But oh, you the woman, you don't have the right. Even if you are to inherit, in fact, you are going to inherit only around 30%. And let me make it clear. In fact, however, in Sierra Leone, women were considered as part of the property of the husband. And being the property of the, could you imagine how barbaric, how inhuman, how ungodly that was? That imagine a woman being considered as the property of the husband. And when the husband died, that woman should be inherited by either a close relative. Can you imagine that? A woman being inherited by a close relative, a brother, etc. That sounds so odd. But anyway, let's see what's going to happen. Of course, the act also states that dowry, that is property or money, bought by a bride to her family, should not be returned by the woman's family. This was very serious. Now, at first they were saying, you cannot leave me. If you leave me now, I will go to your family to repay back the bride price. And some families were so poor that they cannot be able to reform. So this was able to keep the woman in bondage in that marriage. And being in bondage, the woman will continue to suffer just because that woman does not have the ability, or the family of that woman does not have the ability to reform. Now, let me tell you this. This act makes it clear that, in fact, no dowries can be refunded. In fact, a man cannot be able to pay a woman for the time they spent, for the children they've delivered, she's delivered for that man. Automatically, the woman has a lot of contributions she might have done, either directly or indirectly, to the life of this man. Therefore, the reform is not possible anymore. So the act injected a lot of some justice, systematic concepts into the lives of Sierra Leoneans that have now paved the roadmap for social workers to intervene, for social workers to fight on behalf of women, for social workers to promote gender equality, for social workers to really understand and pioneer the concept of gender equality. Ladies and gentlemen, proceed. Well, actually, the legitimization of partners cohabiting for more than 5 years was also introduced before this time. Are you getting that? Now let me just explain it. Before this time, unmarried couples cohabiting were not protected by law. And in the case of death or separation, they are not considered because they are not legally married, which has great effect on maintenance and welfare of children. Very serious. This very, very serious. Let me just throw light on that. You know, prior to this, to 2007, we realized that, you know, some men will say, okay, she will stay with me, I will not marry her. And when they separate, even if they have stayed for 10 years, when they separate, they will now say, she does not have access to my property because we are not married. That was what men were quoting. And then, now this act is saying, when you have stayed together for a period of not less than 5 years, even if you do not marry that woman, when you divorce, that woman has access to your property. As far as we are concerned, she is a legitimate wife to you. As far as we are concerned, she is your wife because you stayed with her for 5 years, you spent time with her for 5 years, you never complained for 5 years, you never rejected her for 5 years, you are not good. So you see, I am not saying that wicked men, because some of you know you, I am not saying that you should now go collect the woman, and when it is four years, 9 months, automatically decide to change your mind. That is not going to work. In fact, we are also going to intervene as social worker to see how we can fight justice, because that is injustice. Some of you are very crafty. I know, having known this now, you may want to use it against women by waiting for when it is close to 5 years for you to do it. But even as at that, we can still intervene. Take note. However, with respect to polygamous marriages, the act states that if a man wants to marry more than 4 wives, it should be done under customary marriage. Of course, for those who are Muslims, they have the right to marry 4 wives, definitely. But if, for example, you are a Christian and you started getting married, you are supposed to marry 1 wife. But if you intend to make it 2, then you should ensure that you find another one. So definitely. But however, I'm sure Sierra Leoneans who are Christians do not marry 2 wives. I don't want to dive into that much. Ladies and gentlemen, this is how we summarize the Registration of Customary Marriage and Divorce Act, and I'm sure you understood what I've just said. The act is similar to the others, but one important thing I like about the act is consent before marriage. Getting partners again, that you are together now, you after 5 years, definitely your wife is now entitled to your properties. Now we move on to the Devolution of Estate Act 2007. 2007 again. I'm not attending the law. Now, one of the notable changes introduced under the Act is that there should be no discrimination between male and female. Now, what is the evolution of this data? This Act is primarily talking about sharing of property. Ladies and gentlemen, as I've stated under the Registration of Customary Marriage and Divorce Act, that properties, women were not opportune to inherit properties of their wives. Whenever I remember this, I always think of a very great writer, you know, Nigerian writer, in his book, Lonely Days. Bayo Adebowale actually explained the story of Ogidu, oh my goodness, whose name is Yayemi. Yayemi, a very beautiful woman, even at the age of 50, she's strong, energetic, attractive. Her back really knows something to talk about. Yayemi, being so beautiful and attractive, lost the only man she loved, and that man, Ajimobi. According to the story, we saw how this woman suffered humiliation because the woman was forced to remarry. The woman was forced by the husband's family to remarry. The woman was, in fact, they even accused her as being responsible for the death of her husband, which was why she spent her life in loneliness. However, there are a lot of other circumstances that actually prompted Yayemi to become a lonely woman. But that is not our subject of discussion. We proceed. So, however, the Devolution of Estate Act actually focuses on how women's, how properties should be shared. And these properties, of course, between families in case the husband died. Of course, they should be treated equally. Now, men and women should be treated equally whenever they have the equal right to property. They have the equal right to inheritance. They should not be discriminated, etc. That is one thing that we learned here. Also, husband and wife now have right to inherit property of each other. Previously, when the man dies, especially under customary marriage, the woman does not have the right to inherit her husband's property. This act will improve the economic status of, you see, at first, when the husband died, the woman does not have rights. But when the woman died, the husband, see how barbaric and ungodly it was. Anyway. Unmarried couples who cohabit, I've just explained that is why I said they have interrelationship. There are a lot of other things. If you want to know much about this, you can easily check, you know, about the full act and read it, and that will give you more knowledge. However, the Devolution of Estate Act, and that will be the Restriction of Customary Marriage Act, see a similar characteristics and features. Let's move on to the Domestic Violence Act 2007. The same reason why this act we have passed. Well, the same reason why this act was passed as well. That is why the three acts, we combine them and we call them what? The gender laws of Sierra Leone. Let's see what the Domestic Violence Act says. The law makes domestic violence a crime punishable by law prior to the passing of this act. Prior to the passing of this act, it was punishable. That was actually in the Constitution. But again, in fact, even prior to this act, international treaties that we assigned prohibit domestic violence. It prohibits the battery of women. Let me check you as social workers. We have a convention called the Convention for the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, which we popularly call the CEDAW Convention. And the CEDAW Convention, passed by the United Nations, automatically prohibits domestic violence. It actually protects the interests of women. It actually looks at how women are significant people that contribute to economic development and how women can be protected. And prior to the Domestic Violence Act, these laws were in existence. We also had the Resolution 1320. We also had the Resolution 1820. We had the Resolution 1325. We had the Resolution 2000. These resolutions were all there to pinpoint the fact that indeed countries across the world should ensure that they protect the rights of women. Countries across the world should ensure that women become a primary concern because they are considered as the weaker sex. However, the coming of the Domestic Violence Act is now to domesticate some of these legal conventions. It's now to ensure that they practicalize and apply it in Sierra Leone so that at least, but even prior to that, it was in the Constitution of Sierra Leone. Social workers, take notes. Move on. This act also makes provision to strengthen the ability on family support. See that? At first, it was family support unit that was responsible for these cases. And even up to now, the family support unit under the Sierra Leone Police is working tremendously hard to ensure that they protect the rights of women. Yes. Let's proceed. Okay? Also, victims of domestic violence now have the right to seek redress in the court of law without fear of reprisal by perpetrators. If you, for example, you have been offended, you have constantly been harassed, beaten by your husband, etc. Also, there are certain women who beat up their husbands, so let's don't leave that one. I know of a man whose name I cannot call for security reasons. Anytime they fight with the wife, the wife will always be flogging him, and automatically the wife will be on top, crying at the same time, pretending as if these things happen. So don't only think that this act is there for women, but also if you are a woman and they are flogging your husband or they are maltreating your husband, then automatically we go for you as well. The act is also there because gender equality must prevail. Not only some women are weak, some men possess weakness in them. Now let's see what happens. The relevance of the gender acts to social workers. What we discuss now is very relevant. Very, very relevant. What are the relevance of this? One, it guides social workers in carrying out their duties, especially in helping clients whose rights have been violated. See that? We now understand that this act exists. What we need to do at this point is to go understand, read in detail, get more knowledge, and then we now have the tool, the weapon, to fight against injustice. And when our clients are being victimized, we cannot use the Domestic Violence Act to fight. We cannot use the gender laws to fight. Now let's see. It facilitates the concept of advocacy and sensitization. Of course, whenever we want to sensitize, whenever we want to actually talk about gender-based violence, we want to talk about domestic violence, but we now have a tool to use, which is what the gender law should do. Of course, gender laws serve as a source of projects. Now we know domestic violence, despite the law is there, is still a very serious problem. It's still a very serious issue. Now what we need to do, we can write projects as social workers to facilitate advocacy. We can write projects as social workers to sensitize the people, to understand. We can write projects as social workers to help those who have been victimized. So it serves as what? A source of project proposals. Gender laws helps to foster a sense of equality and development. Definitely, when we actualize and activate these gender laws, one thing we can see is it ensures equality between males and females. And that is why the crime rates in that sector has drastically reduced as compared to prior to this time, or prior to the enactment of this. Of course, it places women in a better position to assume their role in society. See that? It's placed women in the, now that women have been protected by the gender law. We now see that indeed it's strategically positioned to understand and to fight better. It is a fulfillment of the CEDAW Convention, Resolution 1325, 1820, and that of 2000. I've already said that indeed the domestication of these laws in Sierra Leone helped to fulfill the CEDAW Convention. Helped to fulfill the resolution 1325, it helped to fulfill the resolution 2000, etc., which are laws that are internationally connected to help fight domestic violence in Sierra Leone and the world at large, and to also ensure that it protects the rights of women across the world. However, ladies and gentlemen, that will not be our end point. Having discussed this, most scholars have said that the gender law of Sierra Leone is like a toothless bulldog. It barks but does not bite. It has been there but is not effective. It has a lot of weaknesses. So what are some weaknesses as social workers? Well, as we discuss in our discussion period, I'm sure that we can unpack most of the problems, most of the issues that are affecting the performance or the effective functioning of the gender laws of Sierra Leone. What are these weaknesses? One, poor monitoring. There have not been effective monitoring by the government to ensure that these laws are. In fact, most of these laws are only effective in cities and not the villages. We need to think about that. So monitoring is one of the key things we need to. Another weakness is lack of effective sensitization and education. These laws are there, but how many people know? Those people in the village are not aware about these laws. They are still victimizing women. They are still becoming more male chauvinistic and considering women as subject of ridicule. So there has not been thorough sensitization and effective education given to them. Cultural adherence issues. Some cultures also presume that when the wife does something, you have to flog that wife. In fact, some cultures also subject women to a lot of things. And because of cultural adherence issues, these laws are not effective in some parts of the country. Say, for example, a man who believes that when the wife does something, she should be treated anyhow. Those kind of things. How can we affect that? We need to go to that village level. Low level of enforcement at village level, of course, that's another weakness. Inadequate form. They have not been proper form because funds need to be given to employ qualified personnel like social workers who will be there to sensitize the people, who will be there to facilitate the actualization of this. And of course, most of those, I'm not saying those who are actually there to enforce the law, the Domestic Violence Act and the police force and executing other issues are not qualified, but they need more training. So funds need to be provided. Again, lack of qualified personnel, I've also mentioned that. Discrimination for other sexes. Now, the Domestic Violence Act only make reference to males and females. What about those lesbians? What about those homosexuals? Yes, as social workers, we are concerned about those individuals because they are also part of our society. They are part of us, and we must ensure that we protect their own rights as well. We should not only be considering women as the weaker sex. What about the lesbians? What about those homosexuals? What about those that? So we have to think about that. You know, so and the gender, the act does not make reference to those. That is a discrimination, that is another weakness you have to look at. Possible recommendations. Now, to these weaknesses, there are recommendations. One of the recommendations is effective monitoring mechanisms must be instituted. We said there is lack of monitoring, so we need to ensure that we institute thorough mechanisms of monitoring. Also, there should be effective education in the form of media relation, community relation, house-to-house campaign, etc. Let us use house-to-house campaign. We are just playing documentaries and videos and on TV. My uncle in the village does not have a TV, not a radio. Let's go from village to village. Let's sensitize these people. Let them understand. That is why we say effective funding to provide. So the provision of adequate fund, what I'm explaining now, can only be possible when there is what? Adequate fund. See that? Employment of more social workers and training of personnel to man the implementation process. You see that? We need to ensure that we employ more social workers who understand, who have knowledge base in these problem issues to be able to understand. However, lastly, we have a consideration of the gender, other gender, like the LGBTQ. You already know what I mean, the lesbians, bisexuals, we have the transgender, we have those who are gays. We need to consider those ones. They are also very important in this. Now, there are possible questions that I believe we'll discuss during our discussion time. One of those questions is, what are the strengths of the Gender Act in Sierra Leone? Does Gender Act, or does it have a strength? What is that strength? Or what are those strengths? We have to understand. Comment briefly on the role of social workers in implementation of this act. See that? What do you think social workers are doing? Or what are their roles in implementation of this act? Four, which other gender issue do you think should be added to this act based on your observation in the country? What do you think should be added? This act do not prioritize the rights of men. Do you agree or disagree? Justify your answer. It only focuses on women and give a little preference to men. Do you agree? If yes, justify. If no, then discuss. Ladies and gentlemen, this is how we end the lecture. Ladies and gentlemen, I know you enjoy this lecture, and if you do, make no mistake, go to my YouTube channel, Francis K. Dumbuya. After you've gone there, you see a lot of videos, click the subscribe button. By clicking the subscribe button, you'll be getting subsequent notifications for subsequent videos. God bless you. Now you're right home.